It's always a pleasure to be here, even so high. But the place is more Nietzschean, I believe, some Kierkegaardian, yeah, to be in the Switzerland, so high, above all the normal human concerns, yeah, he said. But okay, yeah, we still are interested in them. The original title of this text was A Cold War Between a Medium and Message. And I just tell you a bit how this text was written. This text was written as my talk and my presentation on a conference about the Cold War, the influence of the Cold War on arts and after effect of the Cold War. And I was asked to do that more from the Russian perspective, that more from the Western perspective. So it was supposed to be a relatively big event, yeah. Concentrate around fate of modernism and the role of modernism in a Cold War rhetorics. Now, it explains the strategy of the text. I didn't do that. I say I wrote the text, but I didn't do the presentation. And so, for me, it's an opportunity to present this text that otherwise simply arrested on my table, yeah, or in a room. Okay, so let me start. There are different possibilities to speak about today's legacy of the classical modernism. One can trace its influence on the contemporary artistic production. One can follow the strategies of the postmodernist and anti-modernist art movements. Now in this talk, I would like to comment on the practices of aesthetic appreciation, evaluation, and also museumification of the art of 20th century. During the recent decades, we have heard many times that in our time anything goes, that there is no artistic canon anymore, that the art history came to its end, meaning that the canonical linear history of art lost its authoritative character. Indeed, we could witness many artworks of the non-Western origin having entered our museum and art exhibition spaces. However, the representation of the Western art of the 20th century in our museums and art spaces remains relatively stable. For example, it does not include or offers only minor examples of the official art of the Soviet Union, of official art of Nazi Germany or fascist Italy of the 1930s. It is also difficult to find there examples of the Western socialist realism. I mean here such communist-oriented painters, French painters like Taslitsky or Fougeron, they will be exhibited actually next year in Paris for the first time. Will be a kind of major exhibition of them. Or Renato Guttuso. But I must also say, I saw for the first time his image in the Ludwig Museum. Yeah, I was together with some other interesting examples of a kind of broken socialist realism. Or early American social realism connected with the New Deal, which was very prolific and very, it is actually, if you go through America, you see everywhere beautiful, beautiful examples of it, but they are not really art historically examined. There's no art historical presentation of that. So it's very strange also situation. What is the reason for this neglect? I would suggest that this reason is primarily not a political but an aesthetic one. Indeed, one is ready to accept the Russian avant-garde and Italian futurism of the 1920s, even when they were not less politically engaged than the next generations of the Russian and Italian artists. The main reason for the negative aesthetic judgment was and still remains the use of the traditional type of figuration. But why the use, or rather reuse, of figuration is bad? Why does this use discredit an artist and put him or her outside the normative art history? Here we are confronted with modernism not as a certain artistic practice, but as a certain tradition of aesthetic judgment, and I would suggest that this tradition survived the modernism as an artistic practice. The foundational document of this tradition was, as we well know, the famous essay by Clement Greenberg, Avant-Garde and Kitsch, from 1939. Greenberg starts his essay with the assertion that the avant-garde is a continuation of the great European artistic tradition. A very strange assertion, actually. A way to, as he says, keep culture moving in the midst of ideological confusion and violence, and may even be described, as he means it, as a type of Alexandrianism. For Greenberg, the avant-garde is not an artistic revolution, having a goal to create a new civilization or a new mankind, but rather an attempt at the imitation of imitation, of the masterpieces inherited by modernity from the great European past. If classical art was an imitation of nature, avant-garde art is an imitation of this imitation. According to Greenberg, the avant-garde art reveals the techniques that traditional art used to produce. The works, whereas Kitsch simply uses these techniques to produce certain effects to make an impression on the primitive, uncritical spectator. That the avant-garde operates mainly by means of abstraction. It removes the what of the artwork to reveal its how. High art presupposes a dispassionate, analytical view of art. Its goal is to eliminate any contamination of the pure contemplation by any low effects related to the objects of artistic representation. Low art or kitsch, on the contrary, functions by exploitations of passions and affects. Here, modernism presents itself as self-criticism of art that takes seriously famous Plato's critique of art. For Plato, art produces effects, whereas philosophy produces knowledge. The effects are good, or rather bad, for the ordinary people. The knowledge is worth of the efforts by the best people. Here's a great divide between aesthetically good art and aesthetically bad art is drawn. Good art produces knowledge. Bad art produces effects. But what kind of knowledge should high art produce? Basically, Greenberg's answer is a knowledge of the beauty, and at the same time, beauty itself. Meanwhile, one has abandoned the Greenbergian ideal of autonomous, affectless beauty. However, the division between knowledge and affect remained. High art was and still is understood as dispassionate production of knowledge. For some time, high art revealed the medium, or later the multimediality under the so-called post-medium condition, or thematize the social, economical, and political conditions of its own production. In our days, the slogan, art is production of knowledge, is understood more and more as an appeal to the collaboration between art and science, including economy, sociology, and anthropology. One can say that high art made a long way from the knowledge of autonomous beauty towards the illustration of different versions of the scientific knowledge. However, the main modernist claim is not given up. True high art still is understood as production of neutral objective knowledge, not as production of affects. The production of affects is a work of populist, spectacular, low art, basically kitsch. And of course, Greenberg believed that the affects in art are related to representations and figurative art. We experience affects and we experience emotion in relation to the artworks only if we recognize the figures that we see on these artworks. So, if we don't want to produce affects, we have to remove all the references to the outside reality, because that is the references that produce feelings, affects, and reaction in the audience. If I do not recognize them, then I'm not affected. I remain a neutral, objective spectator who is able to analyze art in itself without being infected by any strategy of representation. So that was the main modernist idea. What I do now is I like to draw your attention to the fact that inside the modernist pictorial and discursive tradition, we can find an opposite view according to which it is a representational art that is work of knowledge. And on the abstract, purely painterly level, a picture becomes affective. In other words, inside the modernist tradition itself, one can find a view that is perfectly opposed to the view professed by Greenberg and the majority of post-Greenbergian authors. I mean here the theoretical writings von Vasily Kandinsky in the first place. There is very nice description of a typical exhibition of his time, because he also made money by reviewing exhibitions in Munich and other places. So from the 1911, he describes a typical exhibition of that time. Animals in sunlight or shadow, drinking, standing in water, lying on the grass. Near to a crucifixion by a painter who does not believe in Christ. Flowers, human figures sitting, standing, walking. Often they are naked. Many naked women seen foreshortened from behind, apples and silver dishes. The vulgar herd strolls through the rooms and pronounce the pictures nice or splendid. So the point that Kandinsky makes here is that nobody is interested in the content of these images. The figures themselves produce absolute no impression on the audience. Nobody is interested in these naked women, no is interested in flying geese, no is interested in these figures. They are completely irrelevant for the crowd that looks at these images. So the question is, why all these different things, all of them have nothing to do with each other, all of them are totally uninteresting for the public, why they are brought together? And he said they are brought together because all of them are painted. So it's a painted alone that produce some kind of feelings or moods in the audience, not the figures. Figures are completely irrelevant. Here, high art and kitsch exchange the places. According to Kandinsky, the presentations, that means kitsch, are neutral, merely factual. They do not transport any moods and do not affect the spectator. On the contrary, pure painting produces and transports affects and feelings. A picture may be figurative or abstract. What matters is that it uses forms and colors that are needed for the visualization and efficient transmission of certain mood and emotions. What the main point in this argumentation is that the production of the mood has nothing to do with the question, also practical question, real question, sort of realist question, if the painter himself experiences emotional mood or not. So mood is produced not by the artist in this sense, he's not expressionist, but by the picture alone. And he actually says later that he believes somebody would invent a machine that can produce all the combinations of colors and line and produce something mood by painting abstract images so that a painter would not be required there. So what he has in mind is completely automatization and machinization of the mood production, but production of moods and emotions, and not of any kind of knowledge. What is most important in what Kandinsky makes, he makes in the later book point a line to the plane in 1926. This book was written in his time as professor in Bauhaus. And it's completely dedicated to the criticisms of the classical avant-garde and classical suprematism and constructivism. What Kandinsky wants to prove is that all these images are not selective, not really constructive, and not really suprematist. That all of them are forms and colors that translate certain moods and emotions. And now I will show you example of that. So that is beginning of his discussion of the role of the point in the text. He says that the majority of the suprematist and constructivist work is just a quotation, it is a ready-made. It is a quotation of the point in the text. Point in the text is a moment when one sentence ends and next sentence begins. And we discussed that today in a seminar. So as he says, it is a revolutionary sign. It is a sign of revolution. Because it is a revolution that means a certain gap between the end of one sentence, the past, and beginning of the new sentence, the future sentence. So the moment between past and the future. And what Malevich and other painters actually made, they quoted the point from the text as ready-made, and so they produced this effect, this revolutionary effect. But this revolutionary effect does come not out of painting itself, but from the textual context in which the point emerges. So he makes different versions of a point and how a point can be represented in painting. Next one. That is a small Malevich. Next one. That is a real Malevich. I show you illustration, only some illustration. There's a series of illustrations, six illustrations, that shows what happens if you take a point out of the text, give to this point different versions. That can be also a square, that can be also triangle, but it can be also a circle. And so you make a small point, and then you grow it, and then you get suprematist work of art, which is in itself not painterly, but if you want conceptual, and if you want already textual defined. The next point he makes is about the straight line. He says, the entire field of straight line is lyric, a fact which can be explained by the effect of single force. It is a very strange, of course, sentence, but he says that all the rectangular forms of suprematism and also Mondrian and constructivism, all these straight lines only reflect primitive emotions. So straight line is one passion and one emotion. So just to show. So you have different straight lines. Just keep in mind this image because it's very interesting. Yeah, next one. The same as a photograph. So you see this line, electric line, is a lyric line because it brings electricity, and electricity is passion, from one point to another point. So precisely like with a point in a text, these energetic lines are simply quotation and ready-made that transpose to the abstract painting the electrical system. Next photograph. Yeah. So the whole system of transmission of the energy is a combination of straight lines. So every painting is quotational and energetic because it makes this kind of quotations. And then he makes a very interesting point. Why the medium, the point is also discussed in seminar in different terms, why the medium cannot be, in principle, reflected in art. He says that it could be reflected in art when we would be able to invent and demonstrate an infinite painting. Yeah? Because if you create an infinite painting, an infinite plane, then this infinite plane is like medium, it's a presentation of medium. But if you do a certain form, if you give a painting a certain form, then you have at least two horizontal lines and two vertical lines. So you have at least two transmission of energies. It's interesting that at the end of time of his work, it's what Mondrian says. He says horizontal lines are feminine, vertical lines are masculine, and then they go to dance, and that's boogie woogie. So you see this kind of insight into the impossibility of representing medium in painting because of the finitude of the of art. Now it's interesting that, and it's a very famous story, that there were students of Pollock who just painted huge plane, so like many, many meters. And then Greenberg came and made individual painting out of it, and just said, make this, yeah, or make that, and they sold them, yeah? So, yeah, so that is precisely the point where this, Kandinsky judgment is empirically proved. So when he is speaking about the mood, he takes it very seriously. We tend to think, probably in our time, that mood is not so important because... But look, for example, Heideggerian philosophy. Yeah? The mood is Befindlichkeit. Yeah? So mood is a way in which I find myself in relationship to being. Yeah? For Heidegger, the mood is original disclosure of the way of my existence in the world. So the mood is very important. And he also says to the students, I mean Heidegger, that you can change the mood. There are people who are changing the mood when they come into the space, he said. The mood will be better or the mood will be worse. And you immediately feel it, and you can immediately register that. So the relationship to the mood is basic relationship to the mode of our existence in the world. So, if I am an artist who can manipulate the mood, I can manipulate, and that is what Kandinsky means, I can manipulate the very fundamental relationship of humanity to the mood of its being. Yeah? And that what he really believed. He believed that art has incredible ethical responsibility to create a right kind of mood and not the wrong kind of mood. And if you read the speech on art, in the second part of the work, he explains what is a right kind of mood, so positive kind of mood, and what is a negative kind of mood, depressive kind of mood, and so on and so on. Okay. Now I tell the story that illustrates the point. So, there was in Paris, I don't know if you know the story, so I tell it from the beginning to the end. In the 20s and 30s, in Paris, lived a young Slovenian anarchist. His name was Alfons Laurencic. This Alfons Laurencic was very much interested in art, and he was a total fan of the book The Speech on Art by Kandinsky. So he really knew it from the beginning to the end. Now, a Spanish war started. Alfons Laurencic went to Spain to become a member of the anarchist military groups in Barcelona. But he obviously was not able to make a fight. Yeah. He was military completely incapable. So the Republicans made him a director of the prison. They made him a director of the prison for the fascist prisoners. They would take it on the front and brought to this prison, and then they were interrogated by the Republicans. As he started this activity, he decided to apply Kandinsky's theory to his function as a director of a prison. And he built a so-called psychotechnic cells. The psychotechnic cells, you will see them, were built like a Bauhaus, basically Bauhaus installations. They were a very early form of Bauhaus installations. So these prisoners were put inside the psychotechnic cells, but they were also organized and painted in a way that the mood should be depressive and they should become sad. Yeah? This sadness and depression should help them to give new right kind of information to the interrogators. So he used the book not in the positive way, but in the demonic way. So he took not all the points that Kandinsky made at the beginning of the second part, so how it should be, but all the negative examples of what we should avoid. Yeah? Please say. So that is a photograph from that time. It does totally look like real Bauhaus installation, yeah? And from the Bauhaus itself, there's no pictures comparable with this. Look at this specific floor, yeah? It's interesting. I don't know if you know the images and if you're confronted with them. There are the images of the studio of Mondrian. The floor in the studio of Mondrian was organized the same way, so that Mondrian could move in the studio only vertical or horizontal. He couldn't go like that, yeah? But only like his paintings, yeah? The same way. Even if he went from the bed to toilet, he had to make the same movement, yeah? So he used the same principle because it was very famous at that time. He used the same principle for the prisoners. The next one. Please, the next one, the next image. Uh-huh. That is also a kind of reconstruction of painted reconstruction by Pedro Romero. Pedro Romero is a very interesting Spanish conceptual artist who tried to reconstruct the cells and to organize an exhibition in Barcelona, but he didn't work here. The exhibition was not allowed, but he sent me some material, so I took some images from the materials that I got from him. Next one. That is Himmler, who visited this psychotechnic cells after fascists took Barcelona. And he wrote in a book that these cells show all the cruelty of communism. Yeah. So it's interesting that, and in a certain way, I believe that he was sincere. Also, the people who said that they were really shocked and disoriented by this environment. Because if you don't have this experience of modern and contemporary art, and you never visited these exhibitions, you could really have a kind of psychic effect out of that. You know that, for example, people fainted when they were listening to Hugo Ball, yeah, poetry. Or, for example, looked at the surrealist movies. Yeah, so people were really completely disoriented by this kind of art. Now, among many other things, Kandinsky is interesting for me because of another artist that is very well known in the West, but not really totally appreciated in his career. I mean Alexander Rodchenko. Alexander Rodchenko was an assistant of Kandinsky and lived same house with him. And because he was assistant of Kandinsky, he was hated by Malevich, and he was hated by the Russian constructivists because it was suprematist constructivist school. So his association with Kandinsky completely isolated him from the growth of the Russian avant-garde. When we speak about Rodchenko as a part of the Russian avant-garde, we should not forget that he has a completely different genealogy. This genealogy becomes quite clear. Yeah, please make. In the sematization of the line, yeah. Sematization of the line here is almost a quotation from the books, early books by Kandinsky. It's very early work. It's all series from 1921. So it's precisely the time Kandinsky was living in the Soviet Union and Rodchenko was his assistant. Next one. Yeah. It is a so-called dramatic combination between straight and non-straight line, yeah, that creates not a lyric, but dramatic effect. This dramatic effect, in this case, is ascension to the heaven. This image, according to Kandinsky, he describes it in many places, is a Jacob ladder. So it is an abstract representation of the way to the heaven. And the way to the heaven should be only always beginning left, near to the left corner, low corner, and end on the upper side on the right corner. Yeah. So you have this kind of movement. Next one. Okay. You have this combination of straight lines, yeah, and geometric objects. It also very much early photograph by Rodchenko, very much illustrates Kandinsky principle of organization of the space that has nothing to do with constructivist supremacy. It's a completely different principle. Next one. Jacob ladder. Yeah. So if you, it is this movement, yeah? So you have this the same abstraction form that then turned into the kind of a real image, integrating the human figure. Next one. Next, Jacob ladder, yeah? This time as advertisement for the Soviet aviation. Next one. Pretty girls. It's already beginning of the 30s. This time, horizontal movement. Next one. Yeah. And that is very, very typical. So the guys and these girls that is inscribed into the star. Yeah. So, why I take these examples? Now I change them a bit. Why I take these examples? Because it was a time where Kandinsky, who was closest friend of Rodchenko himself, and all the theoreticians of the Russian avant-garde, asked, and now I come to the Cold War, asked a very simple question. The question is, what is the difference between Soviet life and Western life, and how this difference can be shown? And if you read 20s, 30s, official Soviet discussion, all the Soviet discussions were only around this one topic, because the difference was not clear. Look, technology is the same. The same tractors, yeah, the same planes, the same trains. Yeah. So what is the difference? Same people, same workers, same cows, same agriculture. Everything is completely identical. And if you look at suprematism and constructivism, all those geometrical forms are completely identical. So how you can differentiate between Soviet way of life and Western way of life? How it is painterly possible? What's interesting about that is that to the end of the 20s, beginning of the 30s, all the Russian art critics, plus all the leading artists, came to the conclusion that the only difference could be in the mood of the painting. Because even if the Soviet workers do absolutely the same as Western workers, they do that in a different mood. And they do that in a different mood because the Western workers are exploited by the private capital, and so they're unhappy, and the mood is unhappy. Whereas Russian workers doing absolutely the same are happy because they do that for the state and for the best future. So the mood is the only difference, and this difference is not related to anything having to do with figuration and representation. Because the point was that figuration and representation are completely irrelevant. Soviet Union was not a strange, exotic civilization. It was a kind of middle class worker, or the middle, low class, middle class modern society. People lived in the same type of houses. The apartments were almost the same that in the West. The workplace were very similar. So the only thing that could differentiate between them and the West, and that was a question how we can do that if there is a difference, would be in the mood of the paper. At the moment people discovered this mood, they asked the next question. For example, how a cow can be represented in a way that it shows the cow happy? And how to differentiate happy Soviet cow from unhappy Western cow? The same is the train, the tractor. How they can be happy in the Soviet, the participating in building of the Soviet society, and not unhappy like in the West? This question alone, that was repeated time and again, shows that happiness and mood are not understood as psychological characteristic of the depicted persons. So happy should be the image itself and not the people. That is the principal difference between the socialist realism and classical realism. Classical realism is a neutral representation of the individuals with a specific psychology. Classical realism is psychological realism. Social realism, precisely like also Novecento in Italy and all the Western European practices of the 30s, this return to the order and so on and so on, all of them were not psychological in the traditional sense of the word. So all of them followed this Kandinsky idea that happy or unhappy should be the image itself, and not the artist, and not the figure depicted in it. Both are irrelevant. Yeah? In this sense, all this painting is as formalistic and modernist, but formalistic and modernist in a different way. Let us see a couple of examples. Okay, Labas. beginning of the socialist realism. Yeah, metro station. What we see, Jacob, Jacob Leder, the same movement from the left low to the upper right. Yeah, so a complete repetition of this abstract model that was given by Kandinsky, then re-established by Rodchenko. Next one. Happy tractor and happy tank. Yeah. People love it and they have a good feeling about it. That is something that is difficult to imagine in the context of the Western art of the time. So this kind of emotional contact between people and technology. Next one. Small image, but it's very famous image. It's completely, if you look attentively, it is a demonstration. Everybody in white, only one wife in black, and all the images are completely anti-psychological. So everything is totally removed, yeah? Every psychological characterization is completely removed. This image of Deneka was an icon of socialist realism in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. And it shows very well to what degree it's about pure painting and black and white, you know, black and white oppositions, and not about any kind of realist representation. Next one. It's interesting that also Rodchenko presented some images of the prison in this kind, in this case of a labor camp. And he was very interested in labor camp. It was the first labor camp ever built in the Soviet Union, Belomor Canal. It was built in 1933. And it was interesting for him also because it was completely constructivist, yeah, because and functionalist. If we look at the architecture of this first labor camp that was also built by constructivist architects, it is a complete example of the functionalistic architecture school. Now Rodchenko sees that in a very dark mood. Yeah, you will see that next one. Yeah. So first of all, the movement is in the opposite direction, which is for all formalists of the 20s sign of negativity. Yeah. People are also completely depersonalized by the by the relationship to the tools of the work is completely negative. Yeah, they don't do anything that like suffer under the heaviness of this object. The next one, and it, yeah, and it's very interesting image. Because it's image that completely built on the principle of Kandinsky architecture with straight lines and dramatic lines and so on and so on. There is no people there or no shadows, but you see the direction is opposite to the positive direction, and everything looks totally as a prison, and it's a very dark prison. So he suddenly creates a very dark images with very negative mood. Yeah. That means that he can do that and he can do this. Yeah. He shows with his images the range of his possibilities. Interesting that he was so famous in the Soviet Union at that time that all the whole series was published. It was never forbidden. It was published in its entirety. It's more like 30 images. One darker than another. And then at the end, because I almost thought maybe I don't do that, but because Hubertus mentioned Kabakov, and I was asked also then for the people to do some examples of relatively recent art, recent Russian art, and the role that the avant-garde images are playing in this art. I just give you a couple of examples, please. I know it's still Rochenka, so next one. That's a very good one, it's still Rochenka. It's very good, yeah? Incredible. It was published on the cover of this album. Next one. Also Rochenka. All opposite direction, yeah, all imprisonment and so on. Next one. Yeah. So at the beginning of the album of Ilya Kabakov from 1971, it's not the first, it's the second page. The first page is a black square of Malevich, a copy of that. The second page is explanation that this black square of Malevich is what a small child sees sitting in a drawer. He is sitting as a drawer and he doesn't see anything because life is outside. Yeah? So suddenly, black square of Malevich is not an opening of the new world, but a kind of screen that makes the world invisible. So you sit behind the screen, and you see only dark, and you don't know what happens in outside of it. Next one. Yeah. So he can only see small part of the apartment, and also he can hear what happens. And at the end, he begins this move that what made Kabakov famous is, of course, this installation from 1985, the guy who went to the cosmic space from his bed, yeah. So the idea was that he arranged his bed in a way that his bed projected him into outer space, and he began to circulate around the world as a satellite. The installation itself is a supercomputer. But already here, this small boy cannot open the drawer, cannot go outside of the black square. So he goes up, yeah, and he begins to fly into the air. Yeah, that this flying is a second part of the album. Next one. Also, 1971, Bulatov Horizon. If you know Russian avant-garde, if you know Red Cavalry by Malevich, it reproduces Red Cavalry structure. That is an Order of Lenin band as a suprematist form that blocks the way to the horizon. So in this year 1971, Bulatov explained that in a way that this avant-garde surfaces conceal the perspective behind them. So the same idea, you can't reach horizon because horizon is blocked and obscured by contemporary art, actually, by modern contemporary art. If you will be in London, there is now permanent installation by Bulatov, I wouldn't say, in front of Tate Gallery. I wouldn't say that is a very good one, it's a very big one. But the idea is the same. Yeah, you can go for the next one. It's a pretty good, a bit later, so a couple of years later. So you see again this destructive energy, explosive destruction energy. Next one. Квадрат Малевича is the square of Малевича. So also like 1973 or something like that. So the avant-garde art was experienced and interpreted as a part of the prison. Yeah, that is something that seen by Laurentich, that was seen also by Rodchenko. It is a very strange analogy between utopia, Gesamtkunstwerk, and prison. In all these cases, there is a border that you cannot cross. Yeah? You are on the island. If it is utopia, it's an island. So the island is isolated. You can't go away from it, and you can't reach it only accidentally. Gesamtkunstwerk, also described by in the artwork of the future, original text describing Gesamtkunstwerk by Wagner, as something taking place maybe on an island, a festival in which an original tribe totally is involved, so that everybody participates, and there is no spectator. There is no spectator, there is no outside gaze. Impossibility of outside gaze is what constitutes the utopian space, the space of Gesamtkunstwerk, and that is something that also very much, if you read the diary by Hugo Ball, that is what how Hugo Ball describes Cabaret Voltaire. So between Bauhaus installation, functional architecture, utopian closed space, and all of that, there are some similarities and some differences. And these differences cannot be explained or manifested in any objectifying way. They are not figurative. Utopia is not different from dystopia, yeah, or anti-utopia in some particular details of figure. What is different between utopia and dystopia is a mood of the people living there. So again, we have this very strange claim, and I think unreflected claim, the claim not reflected enough, of depict a differences in mood as differences beyond any figurative differences, yeah? Beyond any figuration and beyond any system of representation. So that's what I want to say.